Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to another edition of Aquarium Online Academy. My name is Amanda, and I'm coming to you live from the Aquarium of the Pacific in Long Beach, California. And right now, I'm standing in front of our Shark Lagoon. Now, I should say, maybe I'm not really standing in front of Shark Lagoon. It looks like I am because I'm in a studio right now, and I am joined by some other people helping make this, give us these wonderful images. Alicia is behind the camera there and at the computer, making all these beautiful things appear behind me. And then my friend Stacy and actually Talia are at the computers helping to answer any text questions or to relay to me any questions that you might have during this program. So we would love to invite you to join us during this program because without you, this won't be much of a program. This is our special Ask a Scientist opportunity to focus in on sharks. So the topic today is sharks, and we invite you to ask all those questions that you've been wondering, because sharks are pretty fascinating creatures, and it's hard not to have some questions as you look at them and think about them. They're kind of mesmerizing. So if you have any questions that you would like to ask, we encourage you to go ahead and text us at the number that you see on your screen, 562-286-1838, because we would love to have your contribution to this class today. So while we wait for your text questions to come on in, let's go ahead and take a look at our Shark Lagoon and take a look at the sharks that are in here. Maybe you're not familiar with Shark Lagoon. Maybe you've been here before yourself and seen it. But if you look for any clues in this exhibit, do you have any idea what type of water temperature this might be? I know, it seems like a really weird question to ask. And I'm not asking for a number question, but do you see any evidence in this exhibit of what type of habitat, where the sharks that we're looking at here might be found? Look at some of the bright, colorful things in Shark Lagoon. So this is our large pool at Shark Lagoon. And look at the other animals you see in there. Do you see some other animals that aren't sharks? Ooh, we're getting some great views of our sharks coming right on up to the camera right now, which is great for this class. But if you notice, these colorful things are corals, or artificial coral in this case, in this particular exhibit. But where do corals live? They live in the warm water. So this is a warm water tropical reef habitat. And these are all different types of sharks that could be found in tropical waters in the Pacific Ocean. And so there's also some tropical fish in here too. Now I know one of the questions we often get asked is, why don't the sharks eat the fish in the exhibit? And there's a couple reasons for that. One is that they're not necessarily the types of prey that these different types of sharks would eat, because not all sharks eat the same things. And another reason is that we feed our sharks on a pretty regular basis, and so they're not really looking for any meal when they know that they're going to get a free one handed to them every single day. So let's look at some of the different sharks that are in here. Now you'll notice there are some sharks that are swimming just below the surface of the water. And of course, that's kind of the classic idea that we often have. Oh, here comes one really close. Whoa, that one's actually a zebra shark. And we'll get back to why that's called a zebra shark later. But when you see a shark swimming at the surface, you might see their fin breaking the surface. And that fin is the dorsal fin. And all sharks have dorsal fins, but notice it's not just one dorsal fin on the body of a shark. So here's a great picture of a black tip reef shark. You can guess why they're called black tips, because they have black tips on their fins. And notice they have two of them. They have a tall first dorsal fin and then a little bit smaller second dorsal fin, which actually is something that gives us an indication of how quickly they might swim. So generally speaking, if that first dorsal fin is taller than the second one, they tend to be a little bit faster swimming sharks. If they're about the same, they usually don't do those quick, real big bursts of speed. All right, we have a question that's come in. Why are there fish in the tank? Oh, just that we were looking at Shark Lagoon. And so we were talking about the fact that it's kind of replicating a tropical reef habitat. Zebra shark just keeps coming right on up here. And so they're in this habitat because that's naturally where they would be, the type of habitat these animals would live in. And it helps us just kind of see not just one animal, not just a shark, but also see them with the bigger picture of the ecosystem that they're a part of. So sharks are an important part of that coral reef ecosystem. And then also another question is, why hammerheads have that shape? Oh, Jeffrey and Jake were wondering about that. So while we don't have any hammerheads in this particular exhibit, we do have an exhibit here at the aquarium that has a type of hammerhead, and it's called a bonnethead shark. Sometimes they can be hard to see. They don't grow to be as large as some of the bigger hammerheads, like the great hammerhead. But the bonnethead shark can be about 5 feet long. And, oh, I might be standing in the way of one. There is a zebra shark in the background at the top and the bottom. But let's see if we can find the bonnethead shark. So look carefully for, like I said, it's a shark. It's a type of a hammerhead shark, and it has that really flattened, funny-looking head. Right there. You see it swimming back here? So back up over there. So really neat, interesting-looking animals. Now, why do they have that shape? It's something that scientists have been wondering about for a while. But one thing, we've actually learned a couple things about them. First of all, the fact that their eyes are on the end. And when you watch as they swim, they move their head back and forth. And it actually gives them a pretty good field of vision as they're moving. But you might think, well, what about that area up front? Well, there's another reason why they utilize that space in front. And it's something called ampullae of Lorenzini. So the ampullae of Lorenzini are these little special pores, these organs inside these pores on their heads that look kind of, well, they look like little dots. They look kind of like freckles. But if you, maybe we can see some of them right here. So if you look at this great white shark, you might see some little dots right around the snout area. Like I said, sometimes I think they look like little freckles. And that's where they can actually sense electricity. So they can sense electricity in the water, and you might wonder why that would be necessary. But you have to remember that every living creature that has muscles and is moving, those muscle contractions are happening through electrical impulses. And so that's what sharks can sense, and it can help guide them to their prey. Now, it's not a very strong sense, so don't worry. If you're getting into the water and your heart's beating, technically that's something a shark could sense, but they would have to be 4 inches away from you to be able to sense that. So here's a really great picture of a bonnethead shark swimming through the water. So you can see how they kind of move their head back and forth as they're swimming. But that ampullae of Lorenzini, all covering that big, broad space in the front, helps them to find their food and direct them to their food a little bit better, because it can be really hard for them to see things that are right in front of them. But that space right there in front with all those ampullae of Lorenzini helps guide that shark a little bit better. All right, we're going to get a good close-up view. Now, this is a different type of shark called a sand tiger shark. But do you see those little spots? So like right here, all those little freckle-looking things, those are their ampullae of Lorenzini. And those are the little tiny pores that have the organ inside that allow them to sense electricity. Now, is there anything else that you notice that's interesting about this shark as you're looking at it? I think there's some very interesting things. But as you're looking at that, let me go ahead and let me give you I'll stand out of the way so you can see this picture. But there are some other great pictures or great questions that are coming in. So we have Richie and Tati want to know, how can sharks smell blood from far away? They also want to know, how fast can sharks swim? Those are really good questions. And while we have this picture up, we'll even point out this area of the shark right here. So that would be the nares. The nare, it's N-A-R-E-S for two of them. And that's what the shark uses to help it to smell. So they do have a really good sense of smell. And while we can't smell in the water, because if we were to use our nose, it's connected and goes into our lungs. And if we were to try to breathe in and smell something in the water, that water would go to our lungs and that wouldn't work for us. We'd drown, right? But sharks don't have that problem since they're breathing the water anyway. And so as that water, as they smell whatever sort of chemicals that they would be in the water, these sharks actually have very sensitive nares that can pick up on smells that could be so sensitive. So if you would think of like a big Olympic-sized swimming pool and just drop one little bit of some sort of scent into that water, they would be able to sense it and know that it's there. So if there is some food and you took just a little bit of oil from some type of fish and you dropped it in that pool, they would be able to sense it because they're that sensitive. That's such a great sense for a shark. However, it's not their strongest sense. But let's look also at these sharks right here. So these are a very different type of sharks, but they also have something that you could kind of see on that other shark right by their nose. They have these things called barbels that stick out. And notice these sharks are on the ground. They're at the bottom, and they'll use those barbels to kind of dig through and uncover things that are living in the sand. So little invertebrates that live on the bottom of the ocean, like shrimp, maybe snails, even worms could be, they can actually sense it with those barbels, and also using their ampullae of Lorenzini up around their snout to help them find their food. But if sense of smell isn't their greatest sense, you might wonder what it is. Well, it's actually their sense of hearing. They can sense low frequency sounds and vibrations in the water a mile away. So they have a really good sense of hearing. All right, also, how fast can sharks swim? Well, the fastest swimming shark in the ocean is a shark called a short fin mako shark. And mako sharks have been known to swim up to 46 miles per hour, which is pretty fast for a shark. But most of the time they swim about 1.5 to maybe 5 miles per hour as they're cruising through the ocean. So this is actually a blue shark that you can see right here. And it has that very, very pointed snout. Actually, it's very similar to a mako shark. And they have these really big dark eyes. Actually, let me make sure I am getting my sharks right. Is this a mako or is this a... This is a blue shark, yeah, okay. Wanted to make sure I'm not telling you guys the wrong thing. And it has a very pointed snout, big eyes, and you can see the dorsal fins there. But a mako shark has a tail that allows it to swim very, very quickly. And one of the things that's interesting is to look at a shark and look at the shape of their tail. And if you see that the top part of the tail is about the same length as the bottom part of their tail, we call them lobes, that's probably a shark that swims pretty quickly through the ocean. If they're longer on the top and they don't have a long lobe on the bottom of their tail, that's probably a shark that spends more time sitting on the bottom or that doesn't move very, very quickly. So anyhow, kind of an interesting thing, but that's a blue shark. They're also very fast swimmers. So they have a very sleek torpedo-shaped body that helps them to cut through that water really well. And then Colin wants to know, why do sharks have fins? Well, let's look at it. How do you think it's helping this shark right now? Well, they're up in the water, and one of the things that they're doing when they're swimming is obviously we know that that back fin, which is called a caudal fin, is what the shark uses to propel itself forward as it moves through the water. But then what are the purposes of these other fins? Well, if they only had that caudal fin pushing them forward and they had no other fins on their body, because of the sleek shape that they have, it might cause that shark to kind of spiral through the water. There's nothing kind of giving it some break, kind of like a football. If you throw a football and you throw it correctly, it spirals through the air. Well, a shark's body is shaped very similarly, and if it didn't have these fins, it might kind of spiral out of control. But having those fins in those different locations, the two on the back, there's some on the bottom, there's anal fins, pelvic fins, and then also these two side pectoral fins, they help it to keep upright, swimming straight. These pectoral fins on the side allow it to kind of steer itself and also kind of put on the brakes if they need to. Those are the reasons that the sharks have those fins that help them swim. Notice you don't see the sharks moving those side fins back and forth like this. They're not waving them up and down like you might see some of these other tropical fish in here moving. And the reason for that is just like an airplane. If you were to ride on an airplane, you wouldn't want to look out the window and see the wings flapping up and down. That would not be a comforting sight because the plane wouldn't stay in the air very well. Well, it's kind of like that for a shark as well, because those fins actually are giving them lift. As long as those fins are staying out to the side, it helps their pretty heavy body stay upright and move forward through the ocean and not just sink down to the bottom. So if you ever do see a shark that isn't swimming, I can guarantee where you're going to find it. Down on the bottom. It's going to be just sitting there. So when sharks stop swimming, they tend to sink. They don't have the same things that other bony fish have that help them maintain their buoyancy in the water, called an air bladder or a swim bladder. Sharks don't have that. Instead, they have an oil-filled liver. So a liver inside their body that has lots of oil in it. And if you know much about density and oil and water, how they don't normally mix, if you add water and oil to something, the oil is going to separate and go on top because it's less dense. So having that oil-filled liver inside the shark also helps that shark to stay closer to the surface as it's swimming. All right, Riley wants to know how to tell the age of a shark. Oh, Riley, that's a really good question. And it's one that scientists, it took them a while to figure out how we might be able to do this. Now, with some animals, like bony fish, we can actually look at their ear bones. Well, the thing about sharks is they don't have bones in their body. Now, scientists have found out that looking at the vertebrae, the backbone, which is not made of bone, it's made of cartilage of some sharks, that is one way that they can tell how long a shark may have lived. Kind of like the rings on the tree. So you can count the rings on a tree. They've found that you can do that same thing with ear bones of fish and even vertebrae on sharks. But then they also noticed some sharks that doesn't work very well for. And they came up with another idea. And one of the sharks, called the Greenland shark, which we recently have discovered is the oldest living shark that we're aware of, what they did is they actually looked at the eye of the shark. So they looked at the eye, and they were able to use radio carbon dating to figure out how old that shark was. It's pretty wild. Now there's a kind of a range of how old or how young that might be. So there's a little bit of room for error, but they have determined that they have found a Greenland shark that is probably 200 some years old. Maybe it could be as much as 500. They don't know that for sure. It could be that much, but maybe even 400. So in this range between like 215 or something and 500 something is their range. So if you want to choose a kind of an age in between there, that is how old that they have determined Greenland sharks grow to live. So that is the oldest living vertebrate that we are aware of. Up until this point, we thought maybe it was the whale, the bowhead whale. They can really live a long time, like 200 odd years, but they found the Greenland shark can live even longer than that. But what's really crazy about the Greenland shark is they have to wait until they're about 150 years old to have a baby. So because they have such long lives, it also means that it takes a long time for them to get to maturity where they can have their own baby sharks, which is also very interesting and how sharks reproduce. Charlie says, do sharks hibernate? Oh, that's a good question. It actually used to be believed that some sharks would hibernate because they thought for a while that the whale shark, I think it was the whale shark, or the basking shark, maybe it was the basking shark, they thought would hibernate. They thought, oh, well, we don't see them during times of the year. Maybe they're hibernating. But no, they do not hibernate. Sharks are constantly awake. They breathe underwater, but they're not, they do sleep, but not for extended periods of time. They can kind of shut down their brain kind of half at a time, kind of like a dolphin can do. So they can rest and relax, but they're still awake, maybe not actively moving forward. But this right here is a basking shark. It is one of the largest sharks. It is not the largest shark. The largest one is the whale shark, but you can see that big, gigantic mouth. Now, one thing that's really interesting about them is that scientists have learned that the thing that they use to help them feed is something that they can shed at different times of the years when they're not feeding. So there are times of the year where they're more actively feeding than other times, and they actually shed these things called gill rakers. So do you see the gills on the shark? They're kind of hard to miss because you can see them from the inside of the shark's mouth. So these are their gill arches, and the gills are where the sharks are breathing. But notice, do you see any teeth inside the mouth of the shark at all? Nope. Not really. Nothing visible. Not like the sand tiger shark that we showed you that close-up picture of before with all those sharp rows of teeth sticking out. This one has really small teeth and uses actually gill rakers to help them filter out plankton from the water. So it's not uncommon to see a basking shark with its mouth open because it's constantly swimming to filter out little teeny tiny animals called plankton in the water. And it uses its gill rakers, which are these little filaments that kind of stick forward on their gill arches so that when they're eating that plankton, it doesn't just go right out their gills again, because that would be a big problem, right? If you had these holes in the sides of your head, if your food went in your mouth and then out the gills, that wouldn't work. So these gill rakers will kind of capture that food, kind of like how the baleen works for a whale. And then it can keep them on the inside as the shark's swimming. And then they can eat off the plankton that's getting caught on those gill rakers. Now, just in case you're wondering, yes, basking sharks can close their mouths. I know right now it looks like, wow, how does that mouth ever close? Does it always stay open? A lot of times it is open when they're feeding, but sometimes they do actually have the ability to close it. And they will actually shed those gill rakers, which is kind of interesting. And then Jaden in San Pedro wants to know, how do sharks breathe through their gills? Oh, well, we were kind of talking about that. As the water goes in through their mouth, it goes out over their gills and it passes over all these little filaments. The gills are like little filaments inside inside their bodies. And here we can see the gill slits on a shark. Also notice the number of gill slits. So this great white shark has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 gill slits. And that's true of the majority of shark. There are only, I think, 3 exceptions I know of. One is the frilled shark. It has 6 gill slits. There's another one called the 6-gilled shark, which has, as you might guess, 6 gills. And then there's also one other shark, and it has 7 gills. Can you imagine what that one's called? That's right, the 7-gilled shark. So with those exceptions, all the other sharks have 5 gill slits on each side of their body. So the water is going in through their mouth, and then it comes over the gill slits and comes out to breathe. And so when you see them, when you see their gills, you can actually tell if a shark is exhaling or inhaling as you watch them. So if the gills are open, that means they're exhaling. The water is coming out of their gills. If the gills are kind of closed together, that means they're inhaling. So they're breathing the water in, and then when it opens up, they're breathing the water out. They're exhaling. Now, another thing that sharks use, sometimes those gills are in a place where they could be covered up, even their cousins, the stingrays. And so they have these things called spiracles. And some of the sharks that spend a lot of time sitting at the bottom of the ocean have these spiracles, just like our bamboo shark, right behind their eyes. So they can actually bring water in and out. I want to make sure I had that right. Maybe bring it in through the spiracles and then out again through their gills. So even it doesn't have to be coming in through their mouth all the time. So kind of an interesting thing to notice. Next time you see a shark, see if it's one that has those little spiracles there. And that might tell you a little bit more about the shark. And then we have some more questions. Great. Is a stingray a shark? I love that you're coming up with things that we were just kind of talking about a little bit. The stingray is not a shark, but it is in the same sort of group of animals as sharks because they, like sharks, do not have any bones in their body. So their skeletal structure is made completely of cartilage. Now, their skeletal structure is actually somewhat similar to a shark, except they have much longer pectoral fins. So those are like the side fins on a shark, the pectoral fins. That's what you're looking at on a stingray. Also, stingrays, of course, have this really long tail, and they don't use those their tail to move them through the water. They use those side pectoral fins, whereas a shark uses its caudal fin to push it through the water. And, of course, stingrays have on their tails a stinger, which sharks, of course, do not have. There are no stinging sharks that I'm aware of. And then Gage, whose birthday is today, happy birthday, Gage, wants to know, how old are sharks? So as we mentioned earlier, sharks can live a long time. We used to think maybe only about 80 years or so. Here's a great view of a manta ray that's feeding. So just like the whale shark and the basking shark that feed on plankton, that's also what the manta ray feeds on. Now, and the manta ray is different. It actually doesn't have a stinger. So not all rays are stingrays, just so you know. But they are all relatives of sharks. And, oh, you can also see the spiracles right behind the eyes on that stingray, too. But how old are sharks? They can be very long-lived, maybe up to 500 years old. I think the oldest one, though, is they've determined in its somewhere between the 200s and the 400s. So long-lived. Most sharks probably don't live that long, though. I think they did determine a great white shark recently up to over or just about 100 years old, maybe a little bit older than 100 years that they aged. So good question. Logan wants to know, do sharks sleep? And yes, they do have a way of kind of sleeping, but not like a long-term hibernation that we were talking about earlier. So they'll kind of shut down part of their brain so that they're not actively thinking and working and looking for food, but just enough to kind of keep them somewhat alert as they rest. Wyatt wants to know, how do you feed sharks? And how do we feed sharks here at the aquarium? We actually have a few different methods depending on the type of shark. So the sharks that you see here in Shark Lagoon get fed by a pool from the surface. And so different sharks will eat different kinds of food. We might be feeding them shrimp. We could be feeding them squid. We could be feeding them fillets of other fish. So different types of food, but they can be fed from the surface using a pole. They could also be fed by hand. Like even some of our zebra sharks have been fed by hand. So this is a zebra shark right here. And then we also have our divers that get into our blue cavern habitat, and they feed our leopard sharks. And the leopard sharks get fed by hand. Now this is one that we would feed with a pole. That's a sand tiger shark. And it's really interesting to think about how different sharks are. So they can be very picky eaters. They have different ways that they're fed here at the aquarium. We also have sharks in touch pools, like the bamboo sharks that you saw. And the way we feed them is just by scattering food on top of the water. And then it sinks into the bottom because those are bottom-dwelling sharks that usually will feed on invertebrates like shrimp, like I mentioned earlier. So we might toss some shrimp into the water, and then once the smell of that food gets in the water, then the sharks get really active and they start looking around, swimming, using their barbels to find the food. Oh, here's another great picture of a shark eating. You can see some of the grabbers that are being used. Here's a slow motion picture. Isn't that neat? And look at how that shark eats it. It basically uses its teeth to grab its food, and it doesn't really chew it up. It just swallows it whole. Now, that all depends on the type of shark you're talking about. So I have an example right here of some jaws from a sand tiger shark. That was the one we saw earlier that had really long, pointy teeth. And those teeth are designed to help it capture its food quickly, so something slippery and slimy, maybe a large fish or squid, and then it swallows it whole. Whereas I have another set of jaws here that comes from a zebra shark. So I mentioned zebra shark. We saw it was the shark that was coming up a lot in the surface or up to the camera in our Shark Lagoon cam. And this right here, though, is a great picture because it shows you that this is actually a young zebra shark. And you can kind of see why they're called a zebra shark, because when they are born and they first hatch out of their eggs, and yes, zebra sharks and sharks can lay eggs. In fact, this is an example of what a zebra shark egg looks like. It's pretty big and it's not the prettiest thing in the world, but this picture shows you what it kind of looks like inside the egg. So that big round ball is the yolk sac with the embryo, the little baby shark growing attached to it. When that shark absorbs all of the nutrients in that yolk sac and starts to get bigger, notice the shark embryo is now a lot bigger and the yolk sac is a lot smaller. You don't see that big ball taking up all the space. So that's being absorbed and helping the shark to grow. Now, when that shark gets really big and is able to swim out the end, so it might swim just right out the end of the little egg case here, then it's on its own. Mom and dad don't care for the baby shark at all, and it goes on its own. But when it hatches, it has these black and white stripes that look like the stripes of a zebra. Now, as they get older, those stripes fade away. They turn into spots. You can kind of see that lighter edge. See how it looks like this funny little, almost like a stripe, and those black dots used to be like a black stripe. So that's the zebra shark, and they have these teeth that are really tiny. Even though they're not tiny sharks, they could be about twice my size, but they have these tiny teeth that are really good for helping them to chew and crack open harder shell things. They could eat things with shells, but also like shrimp and the things with the lighter exoskeletons. And so that's what those teeth are. In fact, maybe let me show you just a closer view. If you've never seen zebra shark teeth before, let me try coming over to my document camera and seeing if we can zoom in a little bit. So you can see those teeth are actually really, really tiny. So small teeth for eating small food, very different from the teeth of the mako shark, which, well, probably can't show you very well here. There you can see. They're kind of sharp and long and skinny. Now, this shark, if it was to try to eat the same type of thing that a great shark would eat, a great white shark, those teeth would probably break right off because great white sharks tend to eat the larger animals like big blubbery seals and sea lions. And they have thick teeth and they also have serrated edges on them. So notice how much thicker it is at the bottom, but then at the edges, see these little jagged bumps right here? So this is what allows the shark to kind of bite into something that's really big. It just has to shake its head back and forth, and then these little serrated edges, just like the edges of a knife, the serrated edges of a knife, can cut into something that's too big for it to eat. It will actually cut off smaller chunks for that animal to eat. So sharks do have very different food preferences and very different types of teeth based, well, they all work together. Different teeth based on the food they eat, and different food they eat based on their teeth. So, kind of interesting. All right, there are still some more questions coming in. How big do sharks get? I will get to that, but since we were just talking about teeth, to finish answering Alan's question of how big are sharks' teeth, I did show you a great white shark tooth in my camera. Let me also just hold it up so you can see it in comparison to me. That's a pretty big tooth, a lot bigger than any of the teeth in my mouth. And this is from an adult great white shark, but there is a shark that was known to be bigger than the great white shark. And I'm not talking about the whale shark. The whale shark is the largest living shark, and they can get up to 60 feet in length. So to answer Penny's question, how big do sharks get? The whale shark can be up to 60 feet, maybe even longer, about the size of a school bus plus another like SUV and a half. But one shark that we think was also very big, and how big were their teeth, had bigger teeth, was this shark. This you may have heard of before. This is a model of a fossilized megalodon tooth. So the megalodon had teeth that were very similar. You can see the similar size, or a similar shape, I should say. This one's obviously a lot bigger, but they also have serrated edges on them. So based on what we know about sharks, is about these extinct sharks, really, because nobody was ever around to actually see this with their own eyes. So we don't know exactly how long the megalodon grew to be, but we do know that they existed because we found their teeth in the fossil record. And so based on their teeth being very similar to a great white, we did learn that there's a sort of ratio. If you look at the great white tooth and you compare it to the length of the great white shark, they found that there's a little mathematical equation you can do to figure out how long or how big that great white shark was. So they used that same thing for the megalodon. And so they figure the megalodon was probably even bigger, maybe twice the size of a great white shark. And a great white shark can get up to about 22 feet. Maybe a little bit bigger than that. So the megalodon might have been 40 feet or more. So a big shark. Whale shark, probably still bigger, but I do want to point out that even though the whale shark is the biggest shark, they have the smallest teeth. This right here is a jaw of a whale shark, and their teeth are actually really tiny, because remember, these are animals that feed on plankton, and they don't really need those teeth for much of anything, but there's a little bit of texture, makes them feel kind of rough right there. But that's the inside of, or this is again a model of what the jaw of a whale shark looks like. So very large mouth. All right, we still have a question, how can sharks see underwater? And they have great eyes that allow them to see underwater. They're not the best with noticing colors, but they do see underwater. They have pretty good vision. They can see up to about 70 feet away from them. So they don't need to have that pocket of airspace between their eye and the water like we do when we see, because we're used to looking at land. But they can see through the ocean pretty well, ocean water. Jaden also wants to know, what is the smallest shark in the world? Oh, Jaden, great question, because we talked about the whale shark being the biggest. Well, the smallest is actually smaller than your hand. And so it's called the pocket shark. And it was most recently discovered in the Gulf of Mexico, and it could fit into your hand. And it was about 5.5 inches long. Now, it's possible maybe that shark does grow to be a bit bigger because they have only been seen twice, I want to say, and it's kind of a new discovery. So we're always learning new things in science. And when we think we found like the biggest or the fastest or the longest or the smallest, oftentimes we discover, oh, nope, there is something else out there. We just hadn't seen it before. So it used to be the dwarf lantern shark is what we consider to be the smallest shark, and that was about 7 inches. Then there's the whale shark was the biggest, and those kind of show some of the different, the fastest swimming was the mako shark, and the most endangered, and things like that. So let's go on to this. Elizabeth and Evelyn said, do sharks have ears, and do they hear? And yes, they do have ears. They don't stick out on the side of their bodies like that, but they do have little tiny holes that would allow them to hear, so they can sense the low-frequency vibrations. It's nothing that's very visible to the outside, but they do have the ability to hear. This one right here is a really cute shark called a Port Jackson shark. And what's really cool about them is they have the craziest teeth of all. They have teeth like this that are kind of crazy here. Let me bring it over here. I'm sorry, we are out of time already, but I just want to show you these shark teeth because these jaws are pretty crazy. So they have in the back, let me zoom out. They have these crazy kind of rounded teeth here and then a little bit more pointed up here that allows them to even crack open hard shells like clams with those back teeth. So these teeth will be used to kind of help grab a hold of their food, and then they bring it back inside and they can crush it with those crazy teeth. So that's a Port Jackson shark. Oh, and look at this great picture. This looks like a horned shark. And you can see where their sense of smell is right here. They also have those really pointy teeth right in the front of them. Oh, this one, I'm sorry, this is a Port Jackson as well. So thank you, Alicia, for correcting me. So they're very similar in how they look, but you can see, yeah, the horned shark teeth are a little bit different, but these are great for helping them just grab their food. And then Charlie says, why don't people see sharks near the surface? And some sharks are near the surface. Some sharks live in deeper water. A lot of times sharks try to avoid people. Most likely you have been in the water and maybe a shark has seen you, but you didn't see it because they usually like to stay away from people. So if they do come up to the surface, you might see the dorsal fin breaking the surface. But most of the time when people see a dorsal fin in the water, it's a dolphin, because dolphins have been known to come over a lot closer to people, and you'll see those dorsal fins. They have to come up to the surface to breathe all the time, and sharks don't need to do that. So they can stay deeper in the water where it's a little bit safer for them. Penny asks, how many different sharks are there? That's a great question. About 440 species, actually more than that, I believe, because we're always discovering new species. And Charlie says, why do white fish on the screen have knobs in front of their eyes? Oh, and you may have been talking about the unicorn fish, perhaps. If you're talking about the one that had the horn that kind of sticks out, so that's a unicorn surgeon fish, and we have those in our tropical reef exhibit. Sometimes they just have a big bump, so it's a different type. There's different species of unicorn surgeon fish. Some have a big, long sort of horn, and others are just like a big bump. So they're kind of a whitish gray in color. So, oh, there's part of a sea turtle going by. That's kind of cool. And then Nico and Nathaniel, what animals prey on baby sharks? A lot of different species can. Other sharks can prey on baby sharks. Even sea lions have been known to prey on not just baby sharks, but even some older sharks. Probably other fish as well. So there can be a lot of different things that prey on the young baby sharks. Even birds could prey on them if they were at a place where it was shallow enough where a bird could get it. Marilyn says, what animal can eat a shark? Well, sharks are preyed on by other sharks, and also killer whales, orcas, have been known to prey on sharks as well. Kind of interesting. But the biggest threat to sharks is actually people. And Richie says, are sharks older than dinosaurs? And the answer to that question is yes. So they believe sharks have been around long before the dinosaurs. So they are a very old, old animal. But they are fascinating and fun to watch and fun to look at. So I hope today you feel like you've had all your questions answered about sharks. But if you still have more questions that you would like to ask, we have our team available here to answer any email questions if you would like to email us at live@LBAOP.org. So live@LBAOP.org. You can email us with any questions you might have after this program's over, and we will have staff respond to you. But we want you to know we are here as your resource, and feel free to contact us at any time because we love hearing from you. So thanks again for joining us today, and have a wonderful day. Bye.